Welcome to the Unlicensed Podcast. As always, I'm Caleb. We've got Tassos over here in his fancy new WISPA hat that he picked up from the show. Reppin'. And this week, we're excited to be joined by Jeff Little from Above Wireless. So, everyone knows Jeff. He's kind of famous or infamous or however you want to look at it at times. We're going to talk a lot about tower stuff. We're going to talk about radio deployments, Nate, WISPAPalooza, and kind of a little bit everything else that we want to cover. So, again, Jeff, appreciate you taking the time. Right before we jump into that, though, toss those, give the good people out there their call to action.
Absolutely. Don't forget to like, listen, and subscribe to our channel right here on YouTube or anywhere you download your audio podcasts like Google or Spotify.
All right, Jeff. Hey, man. Really appreciate you taking time out of your busy day. I know you've just recently moved around a bit, had to dig some stuff out of boxes and everything, but we appreciate you taking the time, and we're excited to talk to you, get some background info and stuff like that. So if you want to just do a quick introduction, maybe give some history, like how did you get in this field? How did you decide this is what you wanted to do? And yeah. I don't know, we'll kind of go from there.
What makes you want to climb a tower? You know, like 300, 400 feet. Yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely not the pay, but yeah. Well, for those who don't know me or don't know much about me, I'm Jeff Little with Above Wireless. Started the company back in 2017. So a bit of history about myself is that my dad used to be a tower climber, and I would be out in the field with the BB gun while he was working and stuff like that. And then eventually I came of age where I could legally work with my dad at different companies. And so we started that process, and we started working together. I've been doing towers since I was 17, and eventually I had opportunity to start my own company and did that around 2017, and just been going ever since.
Very cool, very cool. So, and I guess so you do a mix of a little bit of everything, really. So inspections, constructions, D-stacks, installations and stuff like that. I mean, what areas do you guys mainly cover, or is it just a little bit of everything? Like, what do you spend most of your time doing, I suppose?
Well, we try to be well diversified, especially in the different markets. Each year there's different trends versus LNA, stacking, civil work, stuff like that. But a lot of our work is doing equipment installs and tower stacks and general site maintenance, so plumbing tensions, removing rust, loose bolts, stuff like that.
Okay. Yeah, I think a lot of people don't realize that a tower is just not like a static thing that's there forever. Like everything else requires maintenance, right? So, and we see this happen a lot where people will buy, you know, they'll build their own. If you build it from scratch, you learn a lot about this. But so many times people will buy a site and then be surprised when they realize like, oh, the guy wires need tensioning or, you know, things like that. There's always something. I mean, you've got hut maintenance, you've got power, you've got groundwork, you've got all that stuff, trying to keep it from rusting, dealing with storms and stuff. So, you know, there's really a lot that goes into it, and it really gets complicated, especially if you're on a multi-site thing. You know, it's one thing where you're on your own, but when you're sharing a lot of space, especially with some of the big wigs and stuff, it gets to be a real kerfluffle at times, I'm sure.
Yeah, it's definitely smart. Just like your house and your car, you have routine maintenance, or your property will deteriorate very quickly. So if you never do an oil change in your car, that's definitely not going to go very far or last very long. So your towers deal with a lot of stresses and strains and weather and all that stuff. So definitely over time they do deteriorate, and if you can upkeep your structure, you can. I've climbed towers that are over 40 years old.
And wow,
you gotta think, you know, you gotta have that tower standing for so long before you see ROI. So, you know, your responsibility is at least let it last to then. So, but you can make it last for a much longer time, and your ROI would be much greater because, you know, you didn't have to do much. You know, maintenance ain't bad if you do it routinely. Maintenance is expensive when you neglect it, and I have to go and fix and replace and do a lot of stuff to the tower.
Yeah, and I'm sure it's different whether it's a self-supporter, whether it's a guided tower, You know, whether it's in the ground or a tower, let's say on a structure or something like that. But maybe you can give our listeners here like a slight little like what would be the standard kind of maintenance things that they have to think about, from, you know, tightening bolts to tensioning the guys. But, you know, I'm sure there are other things as well, you know.
Yeah. You know, each tower has its different level of complexity as far as how it can go bad. So obviously, the more variables you have, like a guide tower has the most when you deal with wires and all the parts. So those definitely need the most maintenance out of all the structures. That's why I usually try to pitch a self-supporter, even though it is generally 20 to 30% more expensive than a guide tower. Over time, it will save you money because the guide tower is, you know, it takes up a large footprint. You do have to do more routine maintenance. And then, you know, if a storm comes with a particular mile per hour wind, you would need to do maintenance again on that. So depending on your area, I could be coming to visit your site 1 year every year or every 3 to 5 years.
Yeah. And if you don't stay on top, it can get so messy. I mean, I've been out on sites for like, you know, like a legit like multi-carrier site owned by the county or the state or whatever. And you get out there and you're like, this tower goes up and then over and then up and then over and then up. I'm like, yeah, I'll be back in 6 months when you guys fix this. Right. So it's that sort of thing. And like the footprint too, that's always what boggles people's minds is they're like, oh, you know, it's 1,000-foot tower. You know, the guys are this high, but they go so much further out too. That's always a mystery. You've got to clean that whole path clean. You got to make sure that the grounds crews don't do stupid stuff. I mean, how many times have you seen guys that get whacked by a big mower or tractor or something, you know, when they're out there bush hogging? Of course, they're not going to say anything. So
yeah, they just keep going.
Yeah, exactly. They're like, I don't know how this happened. I don't know. And I'm like, well, the roll bar on your tractor is about half ripped off. So I think I see a little bit of a correlation here, but
yeah.
But go ahead.
No, yeah, it's definitely a big thing to think about when you're doing that. Cause yeah, fortunately for me, I make a lot of money of people neglecting their structures. So the more you neglect it, the more money we're going to make. But granted, you know, I'd rather go in and do a quick maintenance repair, plumbing tension, and be out and go help my next client instead of spending 3 days on a site because it's so bad. So
For sure. I'm sure there's also like a lot of maintenance with the ground ring. A lot of times people don't think about that, right? You're like, I've got this amazing ground system. I'm like, yes, this ground system's 25 years old, right? Like, when was the last time it was megged or tested? And you go out there and the straps are all corroded or, you know, busted through or stuff like that. So there's a lot of little bits and pieces that goes. And especially when you're, you know, getting into this business, you know, it's one thing to rely on a crew to come out and knock a quick job out for you, but you've really got to think about it like all your other heavy assets. You know, what is your long-term maintenance strategy, and then who are you paying to do this sort of stuff if you're not qualified to do it for yourself?
Yeah, so the grounding system is very neglected a lot because you can't see it and most people aren't testing it. And a lot of people have a lot of faith in the grounding system, let's say for American Tower and Crown. They do not regularly check it. They believe the same thing as once they install it, they're good, and they'll just kind of waiting for a client to complain. Just like if you're renting a property, your landlord ain't going to fix nothing unless you tell them. So you as a tenant, if you want to know that the system's been checked, request those documents or request that inspection form. And that way you'll know if it was checked routinely or recently or whatever.
Right off.
Yeah, because that could be very costly to you.
Yeah, and that's normally when people realize they have a grounding issue, is when all their shit blew up on a Saturday night in the middle of a thunderstorm. And they're like, oh my God, I don't know, nothing was grounded. So yeah, for sure. So. And that's one of those things too, like, especially when you're renting from these big companies. And I'm guilty of this too. Years ago when I did stuff, you're like, oh, this is American Tower site. Everything is going to be tip top because they've already asked you 40,000 questions, right? But then, like, you know, then it just kind of sits, and it's all super dependent on the site manager. Some of those site managers are on top of it, getting it done, making sure everything's all tip top. But then you'll get to some sites out there and I'm like, dude, this place should be condemned. And so you're like, you know, you've got to just be mindful of that. And especially if you're paying all this big money for these big tower rents and stuff, you know, if you're on a separate tenant or whatever, like, demand that information. That is the other part. Like, make that money that you're spending is super expensive, make sure that you're getting your value out of it too as well.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, how I deal with those clients, I can't really name anybody in particular, but they usually wait till there's quite a bit on the plate before they issue out, hey, go fix these. So normally some of the bigger tower structure owners, they give me 50, 60 sites at a time. And oh, so, wow. You know, it's not like they all went, they needed service at the same time. So yeah, you definitely have to request that and ask for things, you know. It's their responsibility to keep the structure safe and up to par. So definitely request those, and, you know, it'll help you out because, you know, you're paying all that money, use it. That's part of that rent is all that stuff that they're doing to the tower. So request those documents because you're paying for it, essentially.
For sure, for sure. So, you know, the tower industry as a whole has really gone over some pretty significant changes over the last few years. You know, the whole 5G boom, and then more or less what I assume was the bust afterwards, and then, you know, a focus from one type of the systems the other. You know, I know that you've got access to a lot of different crews. You're heavily involved with Nate, and we can talk about Nate here in a few. I think it's important that people understand what that is and what they do. But, you know, what are some of the biggest changes that you've seen, especially when you're, like, you know, our customer base, a WISP, right? You know, when they're having to outsource the work, we see a lot of them that will do their own stuff, but they outsource out the big jobs, right? So that they can't do, or the construction and stuff like that. So, you know, there's definitely been a change of expectations over the years, the last several years, especially how that's going. So where do you see the industry, you know, where has it been? Where do you think the biggest changes have come lately? And then, you know, what do you think going to the future, you know, where are things going?
Well, the industry has definitely been changing quite drastically the past 2-3 years at all levels, down to the WISP. You know, we, you know, 3 years ago, we weren't installing Toronto, you know, and then now it's the majority of the equipment that we're installing. So we're seeing a shift in equipment and use cases. So we see where, you know, yeah, the past 2 years, Toronto's been pretty heavy, but we're starting to notice that it's starting to wing off a little bit, and we're starting to see more ubiquity stuff wanting to get installed, horns getting installed, just other people trying other equipment. You know, some of these WISP, they're not able to afford Toronto unless they have funding, so they have to go back to the old ways. So, you know, 3 years ago, I was either putting in ubiquity with horns or cambium, you know, and, you know, the rich guys were putting in the cambium, the big WISP and stuff like that. So what I'm starting to see is that a lot of the WISP are starting to go up in level. So a lot of these ubiquity users are starting to move up to more trying to get to that carrier grade type style of equipment. And but I'm also starting to see more people starting to start with, so they also need to get that entry level stuff as well. So yep. I think we're in between trends right now. I think that the all the money flowing in WISP right now is starting to trickle down, and they're trying to more or less put in fiber and things like that. And so now what they're doing is getting their customers on wireless, on cheaper gear, until they can feed them with fiber. So we're starting to see a lot more like ubiquity radio installs, stuff like that, just because they only need to get them on till they get the fiber to them. So we see that's a big trend right now, especially with the BEAD about to be releasing out. So that's what we see is happening, is that people will start shifting away from the more expensive gear and just limp them by till they can feed fiber to all.
What are you seeing as far as trends go for frequency band, right? So like you said, probably 3 years ago, everything was 5 gig, right? Obviously 6 is here now, and CBRS was pretty popular. So maybe you can give us just a window into what that looked like for the past 3 to 4 years or something, any transitions or trends and stuff like that.
Yeah, definitely. It was hard and heavy 5G everywhere. And, you know, everybody was loving that. And now that the 6G is coming out, we're starting to see more clients starting to prepare their networks for 6G and stuff like that. So that's the trend we're seeing, that where it's going right now. Right now we know that last year or next year is going to be pretty big for 6G.
And what about CBRS 365 band and stuff? You installing a lot of stuff for that?
That's starting to get more popular. I think more people are getting better educated on the technology and seeing if it works for them in their area. But I believe it's going to be pretty good contender on 6G and CBRS for sure.
Yeah, there's probably a natural timeline. I haven't followed it that close where, you know, you could build a lot of that CBRS stuff as protection areas under a license band to protecting your area from overbuild. So a lot of money poured into that. You know, I don't know at this point if the bead location data has been locked in enough to really sort of stymie that or not. I'm not real sure. But I mean, it also is not just that. It works really well through foliage and things like that. So yeah, we're definitely a lot more richer for options than it was 3, 4, 5 years ago. So
for sure,
we see a lot more tools in the toolbox. I mean, we're seeing guys, I mean, across the board that are, yeah, they're doing fiber. Yeah, they're doing Toronto, but they're also using, you know, smaller setups and micro pops on these same builds to feed an area. You know, you have a really dense area with your Toronto stuff, but there's pockets and stuff where that doesn't make sense, where, you know, you're going to pick up a max of 20 subs, right? So, you know, fill in with your 5 gig, 6 gig stuff as needed, micro pops, so on and so forth. So I would imagine, I think the trickiest part of all that, especially as you mix and match more systems, it's not just the radio side. You know, the radio side is the sexy side, but, you know, it's that real boring stuff like power. How do we get all this fiber up here? You know, what do your squids look like and stuff like that? I think that's definitely an area where people kind of stumble in the learning curve, you know, once they get past the radio side. I don't know. What are you seeing? They're like, here's a 3x3 cabinet, and we need about 40 radios worth of ground gear shoved into this thing. So, hope you brought the lube, right?
Yeah. We definitely are seeing different takes and stuff like that. But what I tell everybody is spend the money on your gear, because especially a spot like OVP, you're dealing with a lot of connections, a lot of terminations, and, you know, I don't know about you, but, you know, maintenance calls add up and they'll eat away at your productivity big time. And, you know, it really helps dress in the site if you're using the proper OVP style. So some of these lists like to do the homebrew style boxes or stuff like that. They try to save money, and then, you know, I've been back before to take it apart and put in the right gear, and they had to pay me twice. So yeah, I definitely try to pitch everyone to use, you know, there's a lot of great products out there. Just needs to be, you know, professional gray, you know, don't make it yourself. So that's the trend I'm starting to see as people are spending the money on buy a Photon and Rosenberger and stuff like that, and getting quality products. And pretty much, you know, these Whisper need to start looking at carriers and see what they do and kind of cheat off of their tests. And because these carriers are spending all the money on the research and development, so use that to your advantage. So if they're using all that expensive gear, it's for a reason. Trust me, that they could skimp out on some money, they will. But that's the bare minimum. They believe that the network will stay up long enough for ROI. Now, that's why we all do this, is for ROI. It's not because it makes us feel good. We're like, we want to make money. And so that's how you do it.
And their equipment costs way, way more. So it's very advantageous to make sure you're protecting it closely. It's not a $500 AP up there, you know?
No.
Yeah, it's one of those things, like, you know, and a big cabinet is expensive, right? But after it gets done, no one has said, oh, I have too much space out there, this is terrible, right? So same as batteries, same as backup, same as your surge protectors, your cabling junctions and stuff. Yes, it's very painful to pay for these things up front, but I mean, it doesn't take a couple of maintenance calls or midnight brake fixes or, you know, the loss in reputation and things like that, where these sort of things really pay off for themselves in spades, for sure.
Yeah, and I mean, the vendor pool now for all that stuff and the cost for it has gotten so, I don't want to say inexpensive, but I mean, the prices have come way down, right? I mean, back in the day, we had no choice but to, you know, build it ourselves because there was nothing. Now you have commercial, you know, type structures and stuff like lightsaber cabinets and air conditioned cabinets, heated cabinets, things that are very cost effective today. I think even at the WISP level, it's just those startup WISPs who have to get burned and learn the hard way like we all did, you know, so they'll try and shave a few bucks because whatever. But I think the transition from, you know, that cheap, frugal way of running your business to, you know, doing it right is a lot shorter. It was a lot longer for us back in the day because the stuff still wasn't there. So I think they're learning quick.
Yeah. I'm seeing a really big trend on, I'm not seeing as much homebrew stuff. Everybody is biting the bullet and getting the right gear. You know, there's sites that I put in over 2 years ago, they've had zero maintenance calls. They've been able to just sit there and make them money. And so it works out great. You know, I have other WISPs that piece and sites together, and there's certain sites I've been to 2-3 times because they didn't want to spend the money on the right stuff. And it unfortunately, once you add it up, you're like, man, you could have just done it right the first time and may have saved money. So
yeah, the cabinets, because I mean, it wasn't that long ago in this space, you know, if you wanted a good cabinet, your DBB or whatever it was, DDB or DBB, I forget, but they were not cheap. And now we've got all these cabinets we have access to through the channel. Biophotons done a lot, the UPIN cabling, the ICT power systems, the lithium batteries that you couldn't get before. I mean, all this is helping significantly for sure. So, okay. What are you seeing? Or I guess let's just backtrack a little bit. You know, you do a lot of work with Nate. I think Nate's, as a whole, like, you know, our industry as a whole doesn't get a lot of attention from the bigger outfits. You know, everyone is so focused on Kears. But I see Nate is seeing the role of the quote-unquote smaller WISP or rural WISP or things like that and where we play in this industry. So I think this would be a good point. Kind of talk a little bit about Nate. I know you've been very active with the stuff they've been doing at various conferences and stuff like that. So just tell us a bit about what Nate, who they are, what they're doing, you know, where we're benefiting, and I don't know, things like that.
Well, yeah, I've been pretty involved in Nate. I love the organization just as much as WISPA. What they do is for people who deal with wireless infrastructure, whether you're a contractor or whatever, that's the organization to kind of help you get more involved in that aspect. Yep. So for Nate, you're able to have avenues for safety programs, safety classes. They also have a lot of material to help you out in your training. So if you're doing in-house training, they have a lot of valuable resources to help you train your employees properly. And the big thing about Nate is obviously safety. We put a lot of time and effort into many different spectrums of safety, whether it's equipment, processes, or just getting more education out there as far as like just regulations that we got to follow. And so, yeah, Nate and WISPA, I think they're going to pair real well together because a lot of these WISP are having to finally hire that guy instead of that two guys running the whole network doing home installs. Actually at the Habitower Climbers, they're getting on, you know, American Tower and Crown sites where they have to have legit certs and proper training and follow the processes. So what Nate does is they'll help you get to that point you in the right direction to make sure you're following that, but also give you an avenue to other contractors and resources. Because when I go to Nate Unite, you know, there's many other suppliers there as well that supply the same thing that y'all buy. They're just not exhibiting at WISPA. So, you know, a lot of these WISPs can really benefit from a Nate membership and participating in Nate events just because of, you know, materials, safety, networking. I know that, you know, I'm not the only wireless contractor out there. So maybe you can find one through Nate where maybe they're in your backyard. You just never knew it. You know, as a wireless contractor, we don't buy billboards or do commercials or advertise, really. So you'll be surprised what's out there. But yeah, Nate's been doing a lot for the wireless industry. They've been helping keeping people safe and helping companies like mine grow and network with the right people. Yep. You know, so it's been pretty beneficial for me, and I think it'll help out a lot of the WISP really get what they need for their tower program to be where it needs to be and help them succeed as well.
So we see you talk often about Nate, obviously, online and in forums and Facebook groups and stuff like that, and at the same time, OSHA. So, like, for the people who don't know, I mean, what's kind of the difference between OSHA and Nate? Seems like they're both safety-oriented. I mean, what's, is there?
Well, with OSHA, that's just the federal standards for us employers, for our workers. So Nate and OSHA are working together because OSHA knew about our industry, but they weren't educated enough to really decide on what is what. You know, we're not really steel guys. We're not electricians. We're just kind of like this different thing that kind of touches everything. So OSHA and Nate work together on helping get these rules and regulations to make sense, because there were certain rules that just didn't really make sense for our industry, and that we just needed to revise them and make it to where we can still do our job efficiently, but also safely as well. So that's where, like, Nate has the FCC OSHA partnership program. They got the STAR initiative program, and those are just programs that are helping us contractors or people who have guys working at elevation work safer, but it's also working together to kind of to get those rules, because there's still some rules out there that make our job a little still dangerous just because they haven't written it in the books yet. So we're working together to make sure everyone can go home every night.
Right. So Nate is an organization and OSHA is the federal regulation. It's kind of like WISPA and the FCC, right? So the FCC is like OSHA, and WISPA tries to get the government to work well and make sense out of how we use spectrum and stuff like that. So I think that's pretty useful information for people to understand the difference and how that works.
Yes. Yeah, that's a perfect example of how our partnership and WISPA's partnership are pretty mutual in how they got to talk to the government and guide them in the right direction, because just as y'all know, there's a lot of things that they're just dumb about, and we need to kind of, like, you know, no, this is how it is, and this is why.
Right.
Yeah, there's a lot of the educational aspect of stuff is hard to miss, and like when you're WISP, you're spread thin, obviously, like a lot of them are, so you're trying to do stuff the best way possible, the safest way possible, but there's just a wealth of knowledge that's, it's not like talked about a whole lot as well. Again, everyone wants to focus on the tech, the network, the radios and stuff, but there's so much that you can learn from just the tower climbing, the side, that side of things, where you can not only do stuff safer, which is obviously the main goal, but also be a lot more efficient, learning to do things like, you know, the first time that me and the crews had to do stuff on my crown site, and here's our 47 portals, here's 8,000 pictures you need, like all that nonsense, paperwork, processes and stuff. And then later on you find they're like, someone's got like an app or something. It's like, oh yeah, you just load your pictures into this and it handles it, right? It's that kind of networking. We're like, obviously somebody's figured this out, but I don't know how, right? Or I don't know, just random stuff I've run into, like different sling systems, different cat heads, the radios. When I'm like, oh, these are actually the good radios that all you guys use, and these are good because they don't suck, and I can actually like talk across the link and things like that for the walkies. So there's so much of that side that, you know, you don't necessarily see in a WISP talk or something like that, where I think you could benefit from things like that, learning common standard practices for just even dumb stuff like cabling, right? I got to put this cable to a tower. Like, how hard could it be? Yeah, you could tape it up, but you can learn that there's slightly better ways to do it. Like, all that little itty-bitty nuts and bolts stuff, the 80-20, right? So the 20% of that whole operation, it takes up 80% of the time. So
you don't just tie knots in the metal guy wire, like, three or four knots, a fishing loop or something?
Yeah, just Crosby it together.
Yeah. All I need is this pack of zip ties and a Mountain Dew. And I'm
gotta
good
use
to go.
The good ones, though. You got to use the good ones.
Yeah. Pandilla 110-pound test zip ties. Just throw a couple on there.
Yeah. Been there, done that. So, but yeah, it's tricks of the trade, like anything else, right? So, and especially if you're new or you're looking to expand into area and you're having to rely on these heavy commercialized sites, your Crowns, your Tower, American Towers and stuff like that. Like, you've got to play by their rules and their games. And none of it's that complicated, but it's very, there's a lot of little niggles and wiggles and stuff in there. So that's where, you know, the more that you can network with people, the more that you can open up your sort of professional Rolodex of people to talk to about this stuff. I think the further you're going to benefit.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. And I would love WISP to come and just kind of participate in a Nate event. They do have a lot of regional events. So if you're a WISP that's trying to find a contractor closer to home for you to help you on pricing, go to a regional event. That's, I go to them. And so you go there, you can shop around for a distributor that may be closer to you, a tower crew that you may need occasionally for maintenance, just right there in your area. And a lot of those Nate events are practically free. I mean, yep, you may have to pay to park your car to go to it, but a lot of the regional events are free. Nate Unite, the exhibit's free. I'm not sure about next year, but every year before, the exhibit was free. So you could just freely come in and check it out and see what they got. And, you know, so I highly recommend WISP just kind of explore the website. There's a lot of stuff just on the website that we give out for free that you can see and get a real sense of if Nate is a good thing for you or the latest event in your area.
No, that's super handy, and especially not expensive, which is always a benefit, right?
So, yeah.
And I think it'd be good too for representation for the WISP industry to the tower industry. You know, there's, you know, over the years, I think there's been a little bit of not bad taste, but, you know, we're just going to focus on carriers. These WISP guys are podunk and don't know anything. And the industry has advanced and changed so much over the years. You know, the more that the tower industry can see how much more advanced our industry is in growing and changing. And then at the same time, the tower industry having to grow and change, you know, as technology changes and the carriers are doing whatever the carriers decide to do this week, you know, I think is definitely mutually beneficial on both sides of the equation.
Oh, yeah. And when I'm at Nate events, I say WISP, and they're like, what? So I got to correct people and tell them what it is. And a lot of them don't even know. They don't know it. Ubiquity. They're like, what is that? You know, so that there's education that needs to happen on both sides. So, you know, there's a lot of contractors, let's say, when work got slow, if they probably would have went to a WISP event and try to get some work, it probably would have helped them out majorly. So both sides, I think, are going to greatly benefit from each other helping each other out, you know, and, you know, bring some contractors of the WISP side to help out. I know me, I say no more than yes to WISP. You know, I need help. We need more contractors to help these WISPs get this gear up. And vice versa, us contractors, we need you WISPs to give us some work so we're healthy, you know. So it's going to be a pretty good relationship if we both start mingling together.
It's definitely a very delicate ecosystem when you look at everything from, you know, how, like you said, you know, one feeds the other, right? You know, you need the WISPs to contract you guys. The WISPs need radio manufacturers to make radios so that way they can continue to provide service. The whole ecosystem is actually really interesting to me, and watching it grow over the years has really been exciting to see.
Yeah, it's been real fun. You know, even with WISP, I'm starting to see that they're starting to branch out more on their classes and the stuff they're offering and doing more tower construction related stuff because, you know, a WISP don't quite need to follow a carrier standard. So WISP, y'all WISP need to come up with your own standards and your own stuff. You know, you know, Ethernet cable can do a lot further stretches than coax. So you know that the support standards could be a particular kind. So it would be great to kind of see WISP kind of take the role and expanding that as far as education for WISP themselves. So just how Nate gets education for us contractors, it'd be great that WISP would be doing the same thing, you know, equipment manufacturers get together and agree upon certain standards and things like that for the lines, you know, that makes everything better for everybody. You know, if you install the product right, you're going to like the product. You know, the product could be great, but you installed it like crap and you are going to blame the equipment. You're like, Well, why isn't this horn working? This is a piece of crap. Oh, yeah, you installed it bad. That's why.
Right.
You know, that, you know,
totally
the product
agree.
Didn't do anything. So, yeah.
Totally agree on your point of view about WISPA putting some sort of standards together and an education for that.
Or we just end up with USB where we've got like a 43rd standard as well, right? So, but I think that, yeah, some educational resources, you know, again, this, when you're starting out new, there's just so much to learn. And then you're like, okay, at what point, and maybe actually this kind of launch into a new leg here is, you know, you're dealing with these customers and, you know, you don't want to give away your business or, you know, talk yourself out of doing business. But at some point, there's probably a peak in the curve of where it makes sense for them to onboard their own people, train them, safety standards, gear, versus where do you rely on bringing in contractors and stuff such as yourselves? I mean, where do you see that kind of conversation going? You know, you wouldn't expect a guy with 1,000 subs as he's building up his business and ramping up. You're not going to expect that guy to be able to build his own sites, right? Build his own towers and stuff. But, you know, he needs to have staff very soon that can break fix a blown up radio, right? Or cable swap or whatever it may be and do it safely. So do you have like some general rule of thumbs or like guidance on how like an outfit needs to look at, you know, where they need to be self-sufficient versus where they need to bring in folks such as yourself? You know, is that a conversation you have or?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I also do consulting services for WISP to help them get a tower program put in. So it's all use case. So let's say you need 10 sites put in ASAP. Contractor's probably going to be your best bet because they're going to go on it, stay on it till it's done. You as a WISP, you know, you can probably go build one site and then you got to go do home stalls another day and then troubleshoot another site. So if you just need a lot of stuff done quickly, contractor's usually your best bet because they're going to stay on it until it's done and they're not distracted by anything else going on. So, but if you're a WISP also putting in 10 sites, you need to make sure that you have somewhat of a tower program so you can do maintenance. So you kind of have to pick the Goldilocks zone. So let's get stuff done, but you also need to be staffed enough to maintain that network size too as well. So I've dealt with one WISP, he had 4 guys. We put in about 40 sites for him.
Wow.
And now we routinely have to go help him out. But now I encouraged him that I'm going to help him get a tower program and let him do that himself. Because for me, I'd rather go do the bigger jobs. You know, I'm not making a lot of money on maintenance. And I'd rather not just send a truck with 2 guys. Yeah, I'd rather send a truck out with 5 guys and make 10 times more money. So I'm encouraging him to staff up and be able to maintain his network. You know, there's a lot of cases where they try to do it themselves and their deadline's coming up. Well, I come in and I get the job done and they are able to get their stuff done on their deadlines and stuff like that. But I also encourage people that, you know, you still got to maintain it. So there's a couple WISPs that they have no tower climbers. They just expect me to come and save them anytime there's something wrong or they need to have something built. And, you know, like I said earlier, I say no more than yes. So it's really hard to keep everybody happy as far as clientele base. So, yeah, I encourage WISP that you need a tower program. If you have anything in the air, you're going to have to touch it again eventually. So, yeah, at least got to have someone ready to go up for sure. And I would say invest. Invest in a tower program to do it wisely. You know, a tower tech, they are expensive. But, you know, you have to use, you can still use them for home installs and stuff like that. Get one of your guys that you do home installs, train him to be a tower guy for maintenance.
Yep.
But yeah, it's all use case. Most of the time, just people want stuff done now. You know, it's hard to get 4 guys willing to climb a tower and then 1 guy responsible enough to drive all the equipment and put it, you know what I mean? So it all depends on how involved you want to be. So there's certain WISP out there that they don't need my help. They've never asked me to come and help them because they got the staff, and that's great. That's not a problem to me at all. But yeah, there's others that have zero, and I have to save them. I had one 2 weeks ago. I have a site down, 100 sub lost. How fast can you be here? I'm like, I'm booked.
Yeah. 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks.
2,000 miles away, right?
Yeah. So yeah, I'm like, man, I mean, even if I wanted to do it now, it'd take me three days to get there. I encourage everyone, you need at least one for sure. But yeah, get a tower program put together. It'll help you out in the long run. It does seem scary, but just like I said before, that's why you have resources like Nate that could help you point you in the right direction and get it put together, you know?
Right on.
Yeah, I think it's definitely one of the big growing pains for someone getting started and ramping up, you know? It's just, you've got to have somebody available. Like, and I've seen it too many times, someone will post out on the list, hey, you know, I got a site down. I can't get my guys out here for a week. You know, what do I do? And it's like, you should probably have someone to get there. I know it takes a bit to get there, and it's tough, but it's definitely one of the things that'll hobble your Google scores or your reliability or your reputation. Sorry, that's the word I was looking for there, you know, faster than that. So it's one of those tough pills you got to swallow for sure. So
yeah, that's something that I've seen as well as, again, you know, about the community working together and, you know, one of the reasons why I like WISPA and organizations like that they bring groups together is often you'll see it where WISPs start helping other WISPs too, right? So they call up their competitor or their whatever, you know, a couple towns over and, you know, they share climbers together as well. So maybe that's, a business model for WISPs to look at as well, you know, is it some way of sharing common resources together to, again, you know, do this thing together. Delivering internet is something we should be doing as a group, you know, not just as an individual thing. Yeah. You know, so
that is one thing that I definitely say is the coolest part of WISPA is that I'm involved in a lot of other organizations besides WISPA and NAE. I'm in TIA. Cool. And a few other local organizations. And no one does it like that. WISPA is pretty unique. I've never seen anybody like people help each other like y'all do. And I think it's pretty awesome. And I think it's very niche. Like no other organization is really doing that. Yeah, other members of NAE kind of help each other out, but it's not like what y'all do and where I've seen competitors help each other out. And it's just like, that's pretty neat. That's pretty cool.
We've even crowdfunded too. And, you know, we've had some WISPs have some, you know, unforeseen health issues and stuff and GoFundMe pages. And like I said, it's the thing that brings me the most joy about this industry because I'm a pretty social guy, you know, a pretty lovable guy. Like people who really know me know that, you know, I care about the people in my circle. You know what I mean? And like I said, it's been incredible to see some of the people reaching into their pockets and really helping people during disasters as well. I mean, there's just so much of that going around in the WISP industry. It, like you said, it is very unique, and I'm happy that I'm in this industry because it's incredible to see some of that stuff.
Yeah, WISP does definitely have that going for it. Its members are definitely more entwined together than all the other organizations I'm dealt with. So yeah, that's very
we should
neat.
Be unstoppable. We should really be unstoppable with, you know, that type of, you know, working together. And I don't know what it's going to take to get it to that next level, but, you know, it's something we should really look into.
Yeah. I mean, I would propose just like a special group for the people that are jitterous like that. That way we have a platform to kind of be able to help each other out, but also communicate together and do something like that. You know, when a storm does hit, we're like, we already know who's in the area. And we're like, all right, let's go get them, guys.
And when there are some like that, it is still kind of loosely operated. But we've I've done a lot of the early storm stuff with like Johnny and other groups for the Gulf area. And they're still now, you know, it has gone from just some random helping thing to there's actually people now who are in charge of their specific states, like in Florida, Louisiana, Mississippi, and stuff like that. So it's kind of grown, but yeah, it would be cool to see not necessarily a new organization, but maybe part of WISPA be, you know, some coordination between all these people, you know?
Yeah, yeah, that's what I meant. Like, yeah, something, yeah. WISPA would, like, kind of, you know, take advantage of that organic Correct. Thing that happened with between the members.
Yep, yep.
Speaking of WISPA, we just got back from Vegas a little bit ago, so I don't know. It feels like it was last week, but I got COVID out there, so when I came
Me
back,
too.
So I kind of, yeah, I've been doing a little time traveling.
Well, I didn't get COVID. If you never test, you'll never get COVID. So.
Yeah, I had like a year old test. I just spit on it and turned colors. So.
The flu.
Yeah, it's just a cold. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, for me, it was.
I think I'm just getting old. It's just recovery time has played into it as well. But anyway, so yes, WISPAPalooza was just recently. You know, for us, I mean, we had a great show as we always do. You know, it was good to see everybody again, talk about our new stuff. You know, that was a good time. What's your feedback? I mean, you've been coming to several of these for the last several years now, so nothing really new under the sun now, but I know you were in some various discussions and stuff. So, you know, what's your take back or what's your feeling on the pulse of things? I think the as a whole, things were a little bit more upbeat, or not that it was down the last show or like the spring show, but I think now that the AFC is launched, right? And everyone's like, okay, we know what this is. The bead stuff is not going to happen. It's not the end of the world. I think there's a lot more like, okay, here's where we are. Let's move forward. I don't know if you saw something similar or completely separate. What's your feedback?
Yeah, I saw that it felt better. I kind of get what you meant. It just nothing really particular. Just the people, the booths, the sessions, just everything about it seemed like everyone was, I guess, doing better. I guess everyone came, I guess they're making money this year and they're a little happier. But yeah, it just seemed real positive. I noticed that a lot of the distributors and everybody just had, they were more excited for what was coming up. The products that are out and coming out, the new toys and stuff look good. Everything seemed real nice. I mean, I enjoy WISPA. I think every year it does better in different areas. I think that they're starting to really listen to the members. I think more people are filling out the survey and voicing their opinion about how they feel about certain things, and WISPA is listening and doing their best on, you know, you can't please everybody, but, you know, if you have 200 people griping about the same thing, you know, well, there we go. We need to fix that for sure. So I see it improving a lot. I'm liking that they have more variety of classes. I know me as a contractor, I'd go to every session if it made sense, but a lot of that stuff doesn't pertain to me. Yep. And now this year I went to more sessions than I ever have because there was more stuff that was in my realm of things of construction side. So I like seeing that WISP is doing more construction things for you guys to help spread some education. And I'm pretty excited for Oklahoma. I haven't heard too much of the details about it, but I think WISP America is going to also be a big improvement as well. So I'm excited for both events.
Definitely agree. I mean, I personally saw an uptick as well, right? So more excitement specifically about 6 gigahertz. You know, again, with the AFC and everything being screwed up and lack of vendors in the space for radios and stuff like that. But I finally felt some actual real excitement from people about, hey, we're going to really start these deployments, regardless of whether, you know, 6 gigahertz is considered you know, covered or whatever the term is for that, protected and what have you, like CBRS is. It's also exciting to see, I mean, Ubiquiti, right, making a comeback now. I mean, first time in 6+ years that they have a new piece of hardware. So thank you. You know, we often talk, you know, sometimes negatively about it, you know, but, they were such a lifeline to this industry. And when they just kind of evaporated around COVID, you know, it really hurt a lot of WISPs. You know what I mean? So I'm grateful and happy to see Ubiquiti finally making a push, and I guess the timing is right for them now on these new hardware platforms. So we'll see where that goes. I mean, even Mimosa, right? Heard some encouraging words from them. Really, this industry would die without a diverse offering of equipment, right? And that's all equipment, not just, you know, no one radio vendor will rule them all. It's unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. So I'm excited to see radio vendors coming online that we've been waiting for. That's very positive. Again, WISP sounding pretty positive about new builds and stuff like that. And yeah, like you said, for some reason, it felt a little bit different, even in the social aspect, you know, after the show and the get-togethers and stuff like that. So exciting stuff. I think the industry went through a very big hiccup, you know, with COVID and everything. And everybody's had to readjust, not just equipment vendors. We see it in the channel itself, right? The distributors, how they work, who they work. There's consolidation going on right now with distributors and stuff. So a lot of changes. I think the industry is finally leveling out and figuring out what's the new mode of operation moving into the future for the next few years and stuff. So really good stuff.
Yeah, the vibe was vibing a lot more than it has been. So it was a good thing. Good thing.
Yeah. So. I think people are starting to see ROI on all the builds they were doing the past couple of years. So uh-huh. little smiles are a little bigger this year.
Yeah.
So cool. So we've been at this a little bit here. We've covered a lot of ground. I mean, we could sit here and probably run our mouths for hours, but we probably do need to look at wrapping this up. So in closing, I guess, Jeff, if anyone's looking for you, like, what would be the best way to find you or any words that you want to close out with? I mean, here's your opportunity to soapbox if you want to, or, you know, whatever you feel, man.
Yeah. Great podcast. I love what you guys are doing. I love that you get a different variety of things. I never thought I would be picked to be on this, so greatly appreciate that. And
we're dropping the standards a lot lately, so
yeah. I know. Yeah.
We got the tower climbers now. What the hell? This thing is, this place is going
man,
to shit.
Man. Yeah, great talk. I like it. Yeah, I feel like we could talk for hours about everything. I got a lot of stuff to say, but yeah, man, I think that everyone kind of gets the gist. I want the WISP to be better prepared, more safer. I'd like y'all to be involved in Nate. Just take an extra look at it for me. Go to their website, see what they have to offer. And, you know, if anybody wants to reach out to me to ask any particular questions about safety, I don't charge for that. If you want to reach out to me for any tower work or any services like that, just Facebook or wherever, however you can get a hold of me.
Website, yeah. Email or something?
No website, email, just jeff@abovewirelessllc.com or Facebook message or
LinkedIn. Y'all do a bunch of stuff on LinkedIn, so.
Right on.
Yeah, that's it, man. Guys, that was awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, sounds good. Tasa, is anybody looking for us? Where can they find us?
Yeah, you could find us all over social media, Facebook groups. Of course, there's always our website, rfelements.com, or you can email us, Tasos or Caleb @rfelements.com.
And until next time, maybe I'll find a way to close this properly. See ya.
Bye.
Bye.